Power supplies are among the most important devices in an electronics laboratory. With their help, it is possible to supply loads such as electronic circuits with a defined DC voltage or even a current limit. Furthermore, in contrast to other sources such as batteries, they offer some safety mechanisms that make it much easier for us to test circuits. So in this video, we will look at how to set up and use these simple but very helpful devices. We will also look at how to create a differential voltage supply that is, for example, often required by operational amplifiers. Let's start very simple. What does a power supply actually look like? There's a big variety of laboratory power supplies on the market, but in our lab we use this power supply. It has three outputs, two of them being able to output a voltage range of 0 to 30 volts and a maximum of 6 ampere, and one output providing fixed 5 volts and a maximum of 3 ampere. In addition, there is a ground connection, which is connected to the building ground via the power cable. Note here that in our case, all outputs are floating and not connected internally. They therefore do not have fixed reference potentials, which can be very advantageous. But if one wants to refer voltages to other potentials, the connections have to be made separately for each channel. This differs from power supply to power supply. Therefore, always check the user manual before using it. To familiarize ourselves with the controls, let's first switch the device on. Initially, all outputs of the power supply are switched off. You can now switch on each output individually or all outputs together with the corresponding buttons. If you want to set the voltage of the active output, you can do this with the rotary control. If both adjustable outputs are active, you can switch between them with the buttons below the rotary control. Pay attention that the power supply unit outputs the last voltage set at the respective output as soon as the output is switched on. Therefore, you should always set the power supply before connecting the circuit to it. In a worst case, circuit components could otherwise be destroyed by too high voltages or currents. The current setting also works in the same way, with the voltage current button being used to switch between the two options. For many circuits, for example differential amplifier or operational amplifier circuits, a differential supply voltage is usually necessary. For example, plus 12 and minus 12 volts. To be able to provide these voltages with our power supply, we need both adjustable outputs. One output is used to supply plus 12 volts, so the plus side is connected to the plus 12 volts connection of the circuit, and the minus side is connected to the reference connection of the circuit. In our case, the reference connection corresponds to the ground connection. Next, we still need the minus 12 volts. For this, we use the second output of the power supply. The minus side is now connected to the minus 12 volt connection of the circuit, and the plus side is connected to the minus side of the other output, which is our reference potential. Finally, we only have to set both outputs to 12 volts. This can either be done individually, or we can set the voltage on one of the outputs and then use the track function of our power supply. This convenient function causes one output to follow the other. Because the reference is once on the plus and once on the minus side of the power supply's outputs, we achieve exactly the desired opposite voltages. Since the connections are not connected internally, we have to connect the individual references ourselves. In the intro of the video, I briefly mentioned that a power supply also offers some safety mechanisms, which, for example, can be very useful for testing circuits. One of these safety mechanisms is the current or voltage limitation. With the help of the current or voltage limitation, it is possible to prevent sensitive components from being exposed to too high currents or voltages and thus being destroyed. To set the current or voltage limitation, our power supply has a button called Display Limit. By pressing this button, we enter limit mode of the device. With this mode, it is possible to set the desired limits for current and voltage using the rotary switch. Pressing the Display Limit button again activates the limitation. If the set current limit is reached, the voltage of the affected output is adjusted so that the current remains under the set limit in any case. The same holds true for the set voltage limit, but in this case the current is adjusted to stay below the set limit. If this possibility of limiting the current or voltage is used, always make sure that the power supply is not regulating the outputs while measuring. Otherwise, the measurements could be falsified. If you use a different power supply, the setting of the current limitation can of course differ from the one described above. A second way of setting this limit, which actually works with almost every power supply, is to short-circuit the two connections, namely plus and minus of the corresponding output. Once this short circuit has been generated, you can activate the output and set the desired current limit directly via the current setting. In our case, you would have to switch to the current setting with the voltage current button and then set the desired current level. Another safety mechanism that this power supply offers and that I would like to mention here is the overcurrent protection. To set the overcurrent protection, our power supply has a button called overcurrent. By pressing this button, you can set the desired maximum current. Pressing the overcurrent button again activates the overcurrent protection. If it is active, the symbol OCP appears on the display. To switch off the OCP, simply press the overcurrent button again. But what happens with this function when the set current limit is reached? When this occurs, the corresponding output is disabled and an error is shown on the display, in this case, trip. In addition, the OCP symbol blinks on the display. It should be mentioned that most other power supplies do not have such an option. These devices will limit the current as described before, but will not deactivate the output. Let's see what we have to do in our case. To reactivate the corresponding output, the overcurrent protection must be deactivated. To avoid destroying the circuit, it should first be disconnected from the power supply. Then, the OCP can be deactivated by selecting the affected output and pressing the overcurrent button. Thus, the output can be reactivated. Our power supply also offers the possibility of overvoltage protection. It is set in the same way as the overcurrent protection, except that the overvoltage button is used and the display shows the letters OVP for overvoltage protection accordingly. Lastly, I want to mention the fixed 5 volts output of our power supply again, which can be very useful when testing electronic circuits. This constant voltage source output of our device is a more or less common function in power supplies. So there are many power supplies on the market that offer this feature, but maybe with other constant voltage levels. Also, some power supplies are programmable, which might be helpful when it comes to more advanced measurements. In summary, in this video, we have learned how to set up a power supply correctly in order to be able to supply loads, such as electronic circuits, under the safest possible conditions. In particular, we looked at the current and voltage limitation, as well as the display limit function of our power supply, which ensure that the connected load is not destroyed by too high current or voltage values. We also learned how to build a differential power supply, which is needed by many circuits. I'm Clara with the Institute of Electronics. I hope you've learned something today, but anyways, thanks for watching.